Good morning and welcome to our webinar, Nature Play, Developing Your Child's Brain. This is a webinar for parents interested in finding out a bit more about the important role that nature plays in healthy brain development for children, and also to get some ideas about what kind of activities we can do with our children now at home and also in our local area or in playgroup settings as restrictions allow. I'm Hayley Crawford, the Family, Youth and Children Development Officer from the City of Port Phillip, and today we'll be joined by two experts in this field, brain injury therapist Ian Hunter and Port Phillip EcoCentre educator Sharon Hunter. Before starting, I'd like to acknowledge the many traditional custodians of the land on which we are meeting and to pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging, and to their continued relationship with the land today. On this screen, you'll see a child-friendly acknowledgement of country from one of our local childcare centres, Bubup Nam in St Kilda, who often venture out and take part in nature play activities at St Kilda Botanic Gardens. Just a bit of housekeeping to get started. The session is an hour and a half. It will be in two parts. Ian will speak for around 45 minutes about the human brain and how best to encourage its development. Then Sharon will speak for about 25 minutes, providing an overview of activities parents can do with their children, with a bit of show and tell at the end of her talk, with some materials and activities you can use. There'll be plenty of time for questions at the end, so please ask questions throughout both talks. We will collate your answers and then read them out to Sharon and Ian at the end. We will try to answer as many as we can. So to ask a question, you'll see on YouTube on the right-hand side of your screen, there is a chat box and you can type your comment where it says say something. It might ask you to create a channel. So to do that, you'll just need to click on your icon in the top right-hand side and then select create channel. If you don't have a YouTube account, you can send us a private message to the EcoCentre Facebook page. Also, we understand you may need to duck away if you have children present, so don't worry too much about missing out because the session will be recorded and you can watch it later on YouTube. To do that, you just need to click on the same URL we sent you to join the webinar. And now I'll hand over to Ian Hunter to introduce himself and begin.
Thank you, Hayley, and thank you, everyone. I'm just sharing my screen at the moment. Okay. Thank you, everyone, for being part of the webinar this morning, and I hope that we will be able to enlighten you about the human brain and about nature play, which is a very important component of developing the brain. So my role in the webinar is to explain the human brain to you. My background is I've been a brain injury therapist for the last 45 years, working with children and adults who have suffered brain injuries either through birth or through traumatic accident. And through my work, I've become amazed at how the brain is adaptive, how it can organize itself, reorganize itself, and it's just an amazing piece of machinery. And where I want to start is with a quote that I found when I was doing some research for this talk. And it's by Marion Diamond, who was one of the first neuroscientists in the 1960s to start investigating brain plasticity. And she was a real pioneer in the field. And she knows the brain, or knew the brain, more than most people. And the quote from her is, "The human brain is the most complex mass of protoplasm on Earth, perhaps even in our galaxy." And that's very true. It's so complex that even with all the research that's been done into the brain, we still don't really understand completely how it works. So I have the unenviable task of trying to explain all of this to you. And where I want to start is to talk about the size of the human brain, and specifically to talk about the number of brain cells that are in our brain. And it's estimated that we have something like 86 billion neurons, which are the brain cells which send messages in the brain, and 85 billion glial cells. So we have a total of somewhere around 170 billion brain cells. Now, I know that sounds like a lot, but I'm pretty sure that most of you would not really comprehend what we're talking about when we're talking about these numbers. So what does 86 billion neurons represent? And the way I want to try and explain it to you is to imagine that I'm a very generous person and I've just given you $1 million. But there's a condition to you receiving $1 million, and that is you have to spend it. I know it's a terrible thing to ask of you, but I need you to spend that $1 million, and I need you to spend it so you're spending the equivalent of $1 per second, every minute, every hour, every day until your money runs out. So we're talking about the equivalent of $36,000 per hour, every hour, until you spend the whole $1 million. Now, when I do this in a live session, I often will ask the audience, how long do you think that $1 million will last? And I get all different ranges of answers, from a couple of days, a couple of hours. But in truth, if you were to start spending that $1 million right now, every second you're spending a dollar, the $1 million would run out on the 10th of June this year. So it's the equivalent of 11 days, 13 hours, 46 minutes. So that's how long it would take to spend $1 million. Now, imagine if I was really, really generous and really, really rich and gave you $1 billion and said to you the same thing, that I need you to spend that $1 billion, a dollar a second, $60 a minute, $36,000 an hour, every hour, every day, every month, until you spend that whole $1 billion. And again, in a live session, I would ask the audience, how long do you think it would last? And it's quite funny because you get such a range of answers. I did it with a family I was working with last week, and the mother said it would last, I think she said 5 months, and the father said 6 months. Some people will say 2 years, 3 years. It's a complete range. I've done this lots and lots of times, and only two people have ever got it right. So the answer is, if I was to give you $1 billion right now, and you started spending a dollar a second, $60 a minute, $36,000 an hour, you would keep spending your money at that rate until the 6th of February, 2052. 2052, which is the equivalent of 31 years, 9 months, 8 days, and 1 hour of spending $36,000 an hour, every hour, every day. So the reason I did this exercise with you is to show you that 1 billion is an enormous number, a huge number. Now try and imagine what 86 billion neurons represents. It's just this mind-boggling number that we cannot imagine. So that's one of the first interesting things about the brain. Another thing I want to talk about is the size of the brain at birth. So when you're born, if you were to measure your brain compared to the eventual size of your brain as an adult. So we're looking at the size of the brain at birth compared to the size of the brain as an adult. And interestingly, humans have the smallest brain at birth compared to their adult size brain. And I've put up a couple of statistics here. And interestingly, these are, I think most people would agree that these are probably the four most intelligent animals on the planet. So if we look at these animals, humans have a brain which is 28% of the adult size at birth. Elephants is 35%, chimpanzees 36%, and dolphins are 42%. So we have the smallest brain at birth compared to our adult size. Now, if we look at the relationship between the size of the brain at birth and eventual size as an adult, what you find is the smaller the brain is compared to adult size, the higher the intelligence of the animal and the ability to have learned behavior. Whereas with an animal that's born with a large brain at birth compared to adult size, has lower intelligence and most of their behavior is instinctive. There's a limited amount of learned behavior, but mostly their behavior is instinctive. So one of the obvious questions then is to say, well, why is the human brain small at birth? If we're the smartest animal on the planet, why are we born with such a small brain? And the reason for that is actually evolution. So when humans were evolving and started to become upright on two legs, the structure of the skeleton changed and the female pelvis actually became smaller. So as we became upright, the pelvis became smaller. And that presented a problem because with a small pelvis, the head had to be small enough to fit through the pelvis. Otherwise, babies would get stuck, the baby would die, and probably the mother would die. And that would be the end of the human race, obviously. So evolution designed the female pelvis to be smaller, but at the same time, the head was smaller. And as a result of the smaller head, our brain was smaller. So that's the reason why humans are born with a small brain compared to their adult size. Consequently, as a result of that, the interesting thing is that humans are born with a structurally and functionally undeveloped brain compared to all other animals. And we can do much less than most other, well, than all animals at birth. And we also have the longest time in development. So from birth until we're fully developed, it's a much longer period of time to allow for development to occur. And because we're born in a functionally undeveloped state, we have to achieve a significant amount of development after birth. So when we think of lots of other animals, they actually develop very quickly after they're born. It's really funny because a lot of animals will learn to walk within the first hour. So if you watch a kitten being born, a puppy, a lamb, they all walk very quickly, usually within the first hour. And even bigger animals will still walk within the first hour. One of the most amazing ones is an elephant. So a baby elephant at birth is approximately 105 kilos. So it's huge compared to a human, which on average is about 3 kilos at birth. And when you're learning to walk, a lot of it, the difficulty is dealing with your body weight. So the heavier you are, the bigger you are, the harder it is to get up to walk. But an elephant, even though it weighs 105 kilos, can still get up to walk within the first hour. And another animal that does it very quickly is a camel. Now, for a camel to learn to walk, it's not just their body weight. They're not as heavy as an elephant, but camels are all legs and all neck. So to walk, they have to deal with this huge leg to body ratio. So what I've done just to show you what it's like for a camel to learn to walk is to show what happens within the first hour of a camel being born and to compare it to what happens to a human in that first hour. And if you're a parent and you've had a watch your baby after birth, you'll realize that in the first hour they spend most of their time sleeping. So let me just show you this video and then I'll talk some more about it.
Pick yourself up, take a deep breath, dust yourself off, start all over again. Nothing's impossible, I have found, for when my chin is on the ground, I pick myself up, dust myself off, and start all over again. Don't lose your confidence if you slip. Be grateful for a pleasant trip and pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and start all over again. Work like a soul inspired till the battle of the day is won. You may be sick and tired, but you'll be a man, my son. Will you remember the famous men who had to fall to rise again? So pick yourself up, take a deep breath, dust yourself off, start all over again. Work like a soul inspired till the battle of the day is won. You may be sick and tired, but you'll be a man, my son. Will you remember the famous men who had to fall to rise again? So take a deep breath, pick yourself up, dust yourself off, start all over again.
So that all happened within the first hour. In fact, some camels can get up to walk within 30 minutes. And you could see how wobbly the camel was, how awkward it was, but it still was able to walk within the first hour. So in that sense, it seems like the camel is way ahead of us. And certainly the camel is way ahead of us in that first hour. However, unlike the camel, the human brain can grow significantly after birth. So the camel is born with a large brain at birth compared to adult size, but ours continues to grow. And in fact, within the first 12 months of being born, the human brain doubles in size and reaches 80% of its adult size by the age of 3. So one of the things that tells you is how important the first 12 months are and the first 3 years, because most of the brain growth occurs in that time. Our brain continues to grow until early teenagehood, but most of it occurs in that first 3 years. So we go past the camel in terms of our development, but unlike the camel, humans are dependent on their environment to complete their brain growth. Now, what that means is that, well, is that it's actually a double-edged sword. There's a good side to that, and there's a not so good side to it. So the good side is that because our brain keeps on growing, and if we're in the correct environment, our brains almost have this unlimited potential. The not so good side is that if we're not placed in the correct environment, our brains will not develop the way they're meant to. And there have been a lot of animal studies on the impact of environmental deprivation on brain development. And in fact, a lot of the early brain plasticity studies, when they were first finding out about how adaptable the human brain is, a lot of those studies were done with animals like rats, where they placed some rats in a deprived environment and other rats in an enriched environment and left them for a period of time, then compared them. And every time they did that, they found that the rats that had been raised in a deprived environment were a long way behind the rats that had been in an enriched environment. Now, you obviously can't do those kind of studies with humans, but unfortunately, there have been situations where humans have been raised in very deprived environments. And one of the most tragic situations was in the 1980s, when the Ceausescu regime in Romania was overthrown. People went into orphanages in Romania and found children who had been placed in those orphanages from babies and had been living in extreme deprivation. It was tragic to see. Some children had been kept in cots most of their life. They were not fed very well. They had very little stimulation. And it was just terrible to look at. And then what you would expect is actually what happened. So when they looked at the babies and toddlers who'd been living in this extremely deprived environment, they found that they had been severely impacted. Their development was way behind. A lot of the children were very late to walk. Some had very little, if any, speech. They had behavior problems. So you kind of expected that. What is really interesting from this situation in Romania is that they did a study 20 years later in the UK of children who had been raised in these orphanages in the 1980s who'd been adopted by British families. So they'd spent the first several years, I think most of them were up to about age of four. So their first 4 years of life had been living in this very deprived environment in the orphanage. They were then adopted out to these families and were raised in a very enriched environment. So they'd gone from a very extremely deprived environment to an enriched environment. And they then studied their brains as adults. So they measured the size of the brain of these children who had been raised in these English families. And what was fascinating was that they found that even though they'd been raised in this enriched environment, their brains on average were 8.6% smaller than the brains of other British people their same age. And from this study, one of the authors of the study made a couple of interesting statements, which I'll read to you. And one of them was, he said that the most striking finding is that the effects on the brain that occurred when they were young in their first 4 years of life have persisted through the rest of their life so far. And what that shows is that the results show neuroplasticity, the ability of the brain to adapt, has its limits. The idea that everything is recoverable, no matter what your experience, isn't necessarily true. Even with the best care, you can still see those signs of that early adversity. So what that is telling you is that the first several years of our lives, especially the first 3 years, are critical for brain development. So, and what we can also learn from these studies, and in particular the Romanian study, is that the deprivation studies show that brain growth is not automatic. So what that means is that when humans are born, we're born in this very undeveloped state. Basically, the first several weeks of life, we sleep, eat, stay awake for a while, go back to sleep, eat, stay awake for a while. And then progressively, things start to develop. But it's not as if we have an alarm clock in our brain. So there isn't an alarm clock that rings at 9 months and says, okay, according to this normal milestone chart, children should be getting up on their hands and knees and starting to crawl around this age, around 9 months. Or there isn't an alarm clock at 12 months that rings and says, okay, according to this milestone chart, children should now be up walking. You better get up walking. So it doesn't work that way. It's not an automatic process. So if it's not automatic, there must be some system in place, because otherwise we would just be limited in how far we developed, especially if we weren't receiving as much environmental stimulation as we should. So what we need to look at now is what is the system that ensures that our brain develops the way that it does. And that system is actually normal development. It's the developmental milestones that babies go through from birth onwards. The interesting thing about post-birth development is that it's not a random process. So even though there are individual variations, because if you've had more than one child yourself, or if you've had friends who've had children around the same time as you have had your own children, you'll observe that they don't do things at exactly the same time. There are those individual variations. But if you were to study a whole group of children, even though there are individual variations, there is a remarkable consistency in that most children will achieve specific milestones at around about the same time. So the defined milestones occur along fairly similar time frames. So we know that children go through these milestones at around about the same time. So that's the first thing we can establish. But the thing about these milestones is that they don't only mark achievements. So the milestone of learning to tummy crawl, or the milestone of learning to crawl on hands and knees, or to get up to walk, or to start using your hands in a fairly sophisticated way, to start making sounds and then gradually developing speech. Each milestone is not just a marker of achievement, it's actually the foundation upon which future learning is built. So let me explain that a bit further. Let's take the milestone of tummy crawling, for example, or hands and knees crawling. So when a baby is learning to tummy crawl or learning to hands and knees crawl, they're actually practicing and developing things that are going to be needed for future milestones. So for example, when a baby is learning to crawl on hands and knees, just the process of getting up on the hands and knees is teaching them about depth perception, because they're no longer lying on the ground. So they have to deal with the visual impact of being off the ground, which teaches them depth perception. It's giving them strength in their arms and legs because they now have to support themselves through their arms and legs. Because they're off the ground now, they're having to deal with balance. So getting up on your hands and knees, suddenly you're no longer just lying on the floor. You're in this very precarious position. So you have to learn to support yourself in that position and to learn to rock backwards and forwards and eventually learn how to move. So in the process of doing all that, you're building the brain, you're developing, you're building foundations for the next stage of development, which is learning to walk. So each of these milestones is preparing you for the next milestone. And one way of thinking about it is to think of building blocks and building a tower. So if you're playing with your baby, for example, or your toddler, and you're building a tower with blocks, how high the tower goes depends on not how strong the final block is. It depends on how strong the foundations are. So the strength of a tower is in the foundations. A good way of understanding that is to think about building a house. So when you build a house, structurally, the most important part of the house is actually the part of the house that you can't see. It's the part of the house that's under the ground. So the foundations are the most critical part of the structural strength of the house. Imagine if you live somewhere where there was no local council with building inspectors, there were no building regulations, and you didn't understand about the importance of foundations, and you decided to build your own house, and you thought, okay, we'll just level the ground off and then we'll start building from there. And you put up the walls and you put up the roof, and eventually you may be able to build the house initially. But the problem is, without foundations, if it's just sitting on the ground, eventually you're going to have problems because the ground moves. It sinks, it slides, there's movement in the soil. And because you don't have the foundations, the movement in the soil will create movement in the structure of the house. And the first problems that you would see is that you would start noticing cracks in the plaster in some of the rooms or all of the rooms. Now, if you still didn't understand the importance of the foundations, you would look at that crack in the wall and think the problem was the crack in the wall. And you would call the plasterer, he would come back, and he would plaster over it, and the painter would come and paint over it. And initially it would look like you'd fixed the problem. But eventually you would find out you hadn't fixed the problem. All you'd done was dealt with the symptom of the problem. Because the problem was not the crack in the wall, the problem was the lack of foundations. And eventually that crack would reappear, cracks would appear somewhere else. And the only way you could fix it is to actually lift the house up and put foundations in and drop it down again. And if you didn't fix it, eventually the house would fall down or would be so structurally unsound, you wouldn't be able to live in it. So what that tells you is structurally, the most important thing in a house are the foundations, and exactly the same thing in the brain. The most important thing are the foundations of development. So that's all the milestones that babies do, that toddlers do. Because what that's doing is helping to develop the brain, create strength in the brain. Now, what I want to talk about is that there are three key principles that you always need to keep in mind when you're dealing with babies, with toddlers, with young children, in terms of their early development and also their play and also teaching them. So the three key principles, the first one is frequency. So by frequency, I mean that if you're providing a stimulation to a child or you're trying to teach them something, you need to repeat it over and over and over and over again, because the brain needs to hear that same thing over and over again. The brain learns by repetition. So frequency of the stimulation is very important. The next principle that's critical is intensity. So by intensity, I mean that you need to give them a strong stimulus. If you're trying to get through to the brain, you need to make it bright. You need to make it attractive. For example, when you're talking to a baby, you instinctively talk louder. You talk in a more animated way. You come close to them because they need to have this strong stimulus to get through to the brain, to develop the pathways, and to get the brain moving and developing. And the third principle is duration. And by duration, I mean that you keep the stimulation going for a long period of time. So you don't try and teach something to a baby for a day and then stop and move on to something else. You need to keep going with that stimulation, that activity over a long period of time. So frequency, intensity, and duration are the three key principles you need to keep in mind. If you think about it, those three principles also apply to lots of other things in our lives. For example, if you want to become an athlete, a very good footballer, a very good tennis player, cricket player, whatever sport you want to excel in, when you think about how you do that, you're actually applying these three principles all the time. You train regularly, every day. You don't just train once a week. When you train hard, and you keep it going for weeks, months, years. You know, it takes elite athletes many, many years of very intensive training to get to the point where they're at that elite level. So frequency, intensity, and duration are critical. And think about your own children developing. They do these things instinctively. Frequency is a really good example, and I'll give you a very good example in my situation. Yesterday, I spent the day with my two-year-old granddaughter. And anyone that has a two-year-old at the moment or have had two-year-olds in the past will know that the two-year-old's favorite word is why. Why. So yesterday, playing with my granddaughter, I think we would have heard the word why 200 times, at least 200 times. Everything you would tell her, why. Now, two-year-olds do that not to annoy you. They do that because they need to get this information into their brains. They need to hear it lots and lots of times. It has to be repeated. And they're kind of asking you to repeat that information all the time. When you play with children, you're playing in this really intense way. You're making it really dramatic. You're making it really fun. You're trying to capture their attention. So that's where the intensity comes in. And in terms of duration, when children play, if they've got a favorite game, they'll want to do it every day for weeks and weeks and weeks. And sometimes to the point where you have to kind of, okay, that's the end of that game. Let's move on to something else. So children actually love frequency, intensity, and duration. And it's almost as if it's their brain telling them, we need to do this. This is how our brain develops. We have to apply these principles. So as I said, you can see it in play. So when children are playing, they're incorporating these principles. Now, if we look at play itself. Play is one of the most critical parts of early brain development. So when they started doing the neuroplasticity research in the 1960s, they found that play had a dramatic effect on the growth of the brain and also on the growth of intelligence. And the way they discovered that, I spoke earlier about the deprivation studies where they put rats into deprived environments and rats into enriched environments. The rats that were living in the enriched environment were almost like in Luna Park for rats, whatever that is. So they were placed in a cage. They had all these obstacles. To get to their food, they had to go through a maze, find their way through the maze to get to the food. And every time they wanted to feed, they had to go through the maze. They were on wheels, so they'd just keep going round and round and round. So they were getting all sorts of stimulation in their Luna Park for rats. The rats in the deprived environment got no opportunity to do these things, no stimulation at all. So the results of those studies showed that the brain grew much more than the brains of the rats in the deprived environment, and their intelligence was much higher. So we know from those early studies that play is a critical part of brain development. And that's where the role of the parent in brain development comes into play, excuse the pun. Because as a parent of a young child, the way you can help your child's brain to develop is to play with them. It's as simple as that. And you play with them in lots of different ways, but when you're playing with them, you're actually helping their brain to develop. So play is a really critical thing. And if you don't play with a child, they will make you play with them if they can, because it's almost as if they're driven to play because they need to play. They have to play because the brain needs to develop. And when you're playing with a child, you're actually stimulating their brain through their sensory pathways. So if we think about our senses, we have five senses. We have the sense of vision, we have hearing, we have taste, smell, and touch. Initially, they're the five ways you can get to the brain. They're the only five ways you can get to the brain. When a baby is born, those senses are very limited. They don't see very much, they don't hear very much, they don't feel very much. But through the environmental stimulation that babies are exposed to, all those senses are stimulated. So when you're playing with a child, you're stimulating those five senses. Now, when we look at those five senses, vision, hearing, touch, taste, and smell, imagine if I was to say to you, you've got these five senses, I'm going to take four of those senses away and leave you with one, but I'm going to give you the choice of which sense you're going to keep. So if I did this to you right now and said, okay, you've got five senses, I'm taking four of them away, which one will you keep? When I do this to a live audience, every single time I do it, there is one sense which 98% of the people choose to keep. And based on those statistics, if you're thinking about this right now, it's probably the sense that you have chosen. And that sense is vision. So 98% of people choose to keep vision. most of the other 2% choose to keep hearing. That's what always happens. But if I changed the way I asked that initial question and said to you, okay, you've got 5 senses, I'm going to take 4 of them away. You can keep 1 of them, but you have to keep the one that's the most important sense for your brain. And when I do that in the live audience...
Sorry, Ian, just from the EcoCentre here. I think we're having a...
Just hang on a sec.
I think we're having a little bit of issues with the audio at the moment, Ian. If you just want to try turning off your video, hopefully that'll improve the connection.
Have we lost the connection?
No, if you're looking good now, it was just a little bit muffled.
Yeah, I think the plug wasn't plugged in. I'm in a different house and it wasn't plugged in properly, but I think I'm fine now.
Perfect. Thanks, Ian. You can continue.
Sorry about that. So when I do that in a live situation and say, okay, now keep the sense that you want, that is the most important one for your brain, you can see people's, they start to think, and then a few hands come up and say, I think it must be touch. And then someone else says, yeah, I agree. I think it must be touch. And in fact, they're right, because if you think about those 5 senses, you can live without vision. Blind people do incredibly well. You can live without hearing. Deaf people do amazingly well. You can live without taste and smell. But you can actually not function without the sense of touch, because touch enables your brain to be in continual contact with your body. You've all experienced probably a very simple way of this touch pathway being interfered with, and it's that situation you have when your leg goes to sleep. So if you're sitting cross-legged or in an awkward position, you start to lose sensation in that leg. Nothing has happened to the leg. It's just that the blood flow to the brain has been limited, which has affected the sensory stimulation reaching the brain. And when your leg goes to sleep, you actually can't use the leg. Like if you try and walk, you have to hop or you have to drag your leg. So without touch, you actually can't move. You can't function. So the most important sense is touch. And the reason why I'm saying this is that when you're playing with your child, you need to incorporate touch. Now, by touch, I mean touching their body, doing rough and tumble play, tickling. Tickling is a great way. Yesterday with my other grandchild, she's 10 months old, we spent like 10 minutes just playing tickling games. And babies love it. They love that sense of touch. So what you're doing when you're playing with a child is you're stimulating the sensory pathways. Now, this leads to the topic of today, which is nature play. And Sharon is going to expand upon this when I finish. But the importance of nature play from a neurological perspective is that nature is the best way of stimulating the brain. Because when you think about it, when you go outside, when you take your child outside, you're taking them into a three-dimensional world. There's depth, there's perception, there's smell, all the senses are instantly being stimulated. And the best way for you to appreciate the importance of nature is to think about the last couple of months, what you've had to endure over the last couple of months as a result of the lockdown that we've all been through. One of the things that the lockdown did, one of the side effects of the lockdown, was it kind of separated us from nature. We were suddenly spending a lot of time inside. We couldn't take children to the park. They couldn't go on all the equipment at parks. They were stuck inside a lot of the time. So if you think about that experience, which it's still ongoing, you start to, it's kind of that situation where something's taken away from you, you suddenly start to appreciate much more. You tended to take it for granted before. But what the lockdown has taught us is the importance of going outside, going into nature, because nature is the best way of stimulating your brain. That's a given. Nature and brain development go hand in hand. The last thing I want to say to you before I hand over to Sharon is to put away the cotton wool. And by that I mean, you obviously need to take care of your child. You have to be a good parent. You make sure they don't get hurt. You're there to protect them. But at the same time, you also need to expose them to the world. They need to go outside. They need to be able to climb. They need to be able to run. Sometimes they might fall over. They might roll on the ground. They're all important things. As long as they're not hurting themselves, they need to explore the world and go off and do all these wonderful things that kids do. We tend to sort of be very, very protective these days, and for good reason, but at the same time, we also have to make sure that we're giving children all these opportunities to explore their bodies, to explore the world, and to stimulate their brain. So we need to protect children, but we also need to give them all these opportunities. So that's it for me at the moment. Sharon now is going to expand on this concept of nature play. And then I will come back after Sharon is finished, and the both of us will then be available to answer your questions. So I'll now hand over to Sharon.
Thank you very much, Ian, and welcome to everyone. We've got lots of people viewing this webinar, and many of you, I'm sure, are parents. Some of you might be early childhood educators, but no matter why you've come to join us this morning, I'm sure that there's something in this webinar for everyone. And I'm hoping to build substantially on what Ian has shared with us, which is incredibly important information. I'm just now going to bring up my share screen so that I can go through a few important things with you. Excuse me, I'm just going to start again. Sorry, that did not work. Might have been too anxious. Hold on, here we go. And there we go. Lovely. All right. So, after hearing everything that Ian has said, we have a sense that now nature is important in the development of a child's brain. Here is a child in Denmark reaching for the stars. He's gone up some willow trees, and this is a wonderful image of the kind of freedom and sense of risk that nature play provides. It provides that unlimited potential, that environment that can give the brain what it needs. Now, I'm certainly not advocating that every child climb up to this height, but this is a wonderful image of this little man who's just enjoying his time in the sky. Often for us, our experience of nature is virtual. We'll be sitting indoors watching incredible shows about geography or, Sir Richard Attenborough looking at the most extraordinary species in the world, etc. And we'll forget to really take ourselves out there. So I'm advocating for taking ourselves out there. This is a lovely quote, which I think is so important, that nature provides the unplanned, the unknown, the unpredictable encounters that are really significant provocations for young people. And that's, again, linking to what Ian said about the unlimited potential that nature environments provide for stimulus for young people. I'd like to just also give a context to nature play in terms of what some of the researchers are saying. And here, Robert London gave a lecture in Toronto in 2005, and this is some time ago, and it's this kind of research is being done all the time. And he says that young child needs to be free to explore the immediate natural world. So place-based nature, being taking your child out in the nature around your own home or where you live, is really important. They are fascinated and rather than fearful of nature, they're fascinated by it, seeing it nature as full of exquisite moments of grace, enchantment, wonder, and awe. And the role of parents is critical at this point. Carried out with sensitivity and understanding, the adults in a child's life can provide a rich natural environment to enable this intense, intimate exploration to take place so that the child is able to enter into a positive, empathic, and loving relationship with nature. And this is where my background comes in. I've worked at the EcoCentre for 5 years now as an environment educator. And prior to that, I taught in schools. But I brought with me all of my experience of parenting three children and watching their normal development very enthusiastically. And I remember back to when my three children were very young and observing them explore our backyard, our park down the road, the beach near our home, and being really conscious of the joy that it brought to them and how that joy translated into their relationship with one another, but also their relationship to nature. And I wanted at this point to say that that empathic, loving relationship with nature is so important at a time of both pandemic crisis, but also in terms of climate breakdown. Young people need to feel connected and they need to feel that they are stewards of nature as they grow up. And it all starts when they're very young. So it's something to think about in regard to this the future of our young kids, is that the children born in 2016 will be 34 in 2050 and 84 in 2100. And how will the likely scenarios of rising temperatures, sea levels increasing, extreme weather experiences affect the course of their lives for these children? So this is part of the study that researchers are doing in terms of nature play and the relationship of young people to nature. And they found that it's really important for them to have that relationship so that they're better prepared for this changed world that they will experience. That's our granddaughter on the right-hand side climbing a tree the other day when she and I were playing. So nature play, building on what Ian has said, provides social, emotional, physical, and spiritual development. There is no doubt in my mind as an educator that this is what happens when I observe young people. I've worked in early learning centers, and I'm sure educators there will relate to this statement. When young kids are out in nature, they become better at being creative and problem solving. It enhances their cognitive abilities. It increases their physical activity, which makes them healthier, and also provides that stimulation to the brain, improves social relations, self-discipline, academic performance, eyesight, and nutrition. The eyesight one is really interesting. They did a study in China with a lot of young kids who were short-sighted, and they discovered that the time spent indoors and in front of computers and technology really didn't do enough for that part of the brain that, when stimulated, develops eyesight. So in fact, the rays of sunlight, and very important for vitamin D, we know that, is also an important stimulus to that part of the brain that works to develop eyesight. And I didn't know that until I read this research. It reduces nature play, reduces stress and the symptoms of attention deficit disorder. And they've also found that in the research, exposure to green space in childhood is associated with much lower risk of psychiatric disorders from adolescence and into childhood. So definitely the research is there to show all the benefits, even past the initial benefits of developing a child's brain from 0 to 6, which are those very important years. So Ian spoke about intensity, duration, or frequency, intensity, and duration being those key principles, those foundations for good and healthy brain development. And he also made the connection to nature play in regards to those three key foundations. So I'm just going to flesh that out a little bit more. Freedom and focus. Kids are out in nature. There is this unlimited potential for them to be involved in all sorts of discoveries. And if you watch kids do that, and when you've taken them out into nature and you take a more hands-off approach, not wrap them up in cotton wool, not be too instructive, not be too guarding against risk, but mitigating risk, because adults are there to do that for kids, but allowing them as much freedom as you possibly can, you will see that they will engage with all of that potential in those three ways. With frequency, they will repeat things. They will get into the water and start splashing and splashing and splashing and splashing until, you know, they're soaking wet. Be prepared for that. They will cross over a log many, many, many times over. They will slide down that muddy hill over and over again to experience the physicality of that and to experience the risk involved in all of these activities. Their brain needs to experience that risk. If they are balancing on a log, they are activating their brains in that process. So this is a great connection to what Ian has said prior. The freedom and focus allows them to engage with frequency, intensity, and duration. If we think about nature play, settings, and this is quite a helpful thing for all of us, is to think about the kinds of environments that we can facilitate for nature play. And they're characterized by these things. Diverse sensory elements. Again, going back to what Ian said about the importance of that sensory stimulation, that five senses, but also that three-dimensional nature of nature allows them to have the depth perception, that risk play. Those environments have sensory elements. The landscape could be hills, water, dirt, flowers. You could go on and on. The risk and challenge, the balancing and climbing sort of elements of it. The novelty and change. So making kids more aware about the seasonal nature of nature, that they actually sort of dress accordingly for those seasons when they go out to do the nature play. European bush kinders and forest kinders and early nature play groups in Europe are very attuned to seasons. So their kids will be fully dressed in wet overall water repellent or resistance overalls, gumboots, hats, and they'll go out in all kinds of weather, snow, rain, to do their nature play. And I think it's really important that we become more accustomed to taking our kids out into all kinds of weather, and that in fact, there's no bad weather day. There's only a different weather day. I think we have quite a lot of resistance to that exploration of weather as part of nature play. But kids, when they're out in it, when they're out in the rain, when they're out in unusual weather, it's quite exciting. It gives them that extra stimulus. It brings that intensity, if you like, to the nature experience. Another aspect of how nature play settings are characterized is the loose materials for play. There's all this wonderful, instead of the Lego pieces, they've got logs and leaves and rocks. Another thing is the place-based cultural and geographical relevance. So the EcoCentre has done a lot of work in the local area to bring kids in connection to nature in their own place with cultural underpinnings. And those are those indigenous meanings associated with the landscape and with landmarks. And that's a lovely added learning that can come with nature play. And in addition, the nature play is child-led. It's really important that we take a step back as adults, not interfere too much. But in taking a step back, it doesn't mean that we are disengaged with what's happening for our child. And this brings about a sort of mindfulness on the part of the adults participating with their child. It would be wonderful if we could leave our technology alone whilst we're with our young people in nature. I know that as a grandmother, this was not a problem for me when I was a parent, because we didn't have mobile phones back then when my children were really young. But as a grandparent, I'm also really aware that I'm tempted to refer to my phone. And I've made a really conscious decision to put my phone away when I'm with our granddaughter and our granddaughters, and not refer to it, because the mindfulness that then I can bring as an adult in engaging with my young person in nature is that I can observe and look for opportunities to perhaps facilitate the curiosity that might come about with something. So your child might find something in nature, and if you're alert to that and very present with them, you can explore that with them, and then again release them and let them lead the next step in the adventure until they need your input again. It's really important that we see our children as capable and competent problem solvers and risk takers. We have to see them with this potential in order for us to feel more confident to just let them lead when they're out in nature. And that's an important sort of reframing, perhaps, of how we see children's capabilities. It also involves sustained and repeated engagement with natural settings in all kinds of weather. So that's a bit of a repetition of what I've already touched on, and also Ian's work and that he's shared with us this morning. And last of all on this list is the fosters communities of caring involving educators and the families. So I know that early learning educators are very keen to bring young people out into nature, and it's lovely that families can be supported in this to do it as well. Now, there's no one way of doing nature play. There are all sorts of settings, and as you can see here, kids will be wonderful at constructing things like the little cubby that was constructed on the left there in the forest. So there's no one way to do it, lots of different ways. But making it as sensory as possible and also seeing the potential for bringing it indoors. Ian alluded to lockdown and the removal of nature space to us in that time, although lots of families would have gone out for their daily walks with their children. There wasn't that availability of nature for extensive periods of time, but it doesn't mean that we can't bring nature into our homes. And as you can see in one of the images there, we can use things that we might find at home, and I'll show you after my slide presentation just a couple of things you can use at home to do this exploration that allows us to bring it indoors or onto the balconies of our apartments. I'm very conscious of the fact that lots of families would be living in apartments perhaps with no backyards or courtyards. And there's all sorts of possibilities of creating little sensory gardens in either trays or in the yellow box there is from a $2 shop, and it's a kitty litter box for $4. And it makes a wonderful sensory garden tray where the imagination is also fused into creating these wonderful little sensory gardens. I'd like to touch on the fact that even when we take very young children out into nature and allow them to explore that natural world, there are all sorts of opportunities for looking at the science, discovering things in the water and wondering what these water bugs are all about. It's really wonderful if kids can get a little collection of these water bugs to look at in that environment. And then after they've had a good look, they release it back into the water. And we can use our mobile phones to take pictures of these things that they find and then maybe have a look at researching them later. So kids are doing science when they're out there. They're doing technology and engineering when they're discovering how to make things, all sorts of things, including fires. So again, in the European examples of bush play, kids are actually taught to make fires. I know that our granddaughter has learned how to light a match to make a fire at home. And it's so beautiful to see her doing it so carefully. And understanding that she's working with materials that can harm her, and she is disciplining herself to mitigate that risk. So they're very capable of knowing what their limits are and how to work with things that are quite tricky. Art is just the most incredible thing that you can do in nature, with nature. Lots of examples of creating art. So these are perhaps extensions to allowing them to lead the play in nature, but then if they find beautiful things that they want to do something with, parents can then provide that guidance for the creation of that art. So we're really giving them unstructured opportunities and then stepping in with some guidance. Mathematics. Kids are all into counting and wanting to repeat counting, and they want to categorize things. So they're looking at putting all the round things together, all the long things together, all the prickly things together. These are all really important activities that they will initiate, and all we have to do as the adults in their life is to encourage and celebrate that and give them little prompts as to what else they can do with those wonderful objects that they find. So kids who have this opportunity from a very young age to provide that important stimulus to their brains using nature as that way of getting the stimulus, and they take with them into their older years, they've passed year six, or they take with them into the rest of their lives high expectations of their abilities, a strong sense of identity, and their relationship with other living things. It's a really wonderful thing when young people discover that their species, that they as a living organism are connected to all these other wondrous living organisms in their world. Such an important fundamental learning for them. And they can get that connection at a very young age if they're allowed to have that exploration. They also take with them this connected sense of that they are connected and that they contribute to the world in some way. I know that young people I've worked with have such a strong sense that when they're inspired by nature, they will say things like, I want to be someone who grows things. They've got all of these wonderful ideas about how they take it into their lives as adults. I want to be a farmer. I want to be a vet. I want to be this. I want to be that. They can see the beauty of their connection to nature at the time when they're really young to something that they can take with them when they're older. They also have a strong sense of well-being. We know as adults what nature gives us in terms of well-being, and this is just magnified for young people. And they're confident, involved learners. If they are given opportunities to be very focused and mindful in nature play, they take that into their learning as they grow. And they also, nature play can also give them a wonderful way of accessing effective communication. If we can provide for them good modeling by allowing them to focus on their play in a mindful way, and then asking them to perhaps tell you as the adult what they've learned, or perhaps describe what they've done. This is the start of that effective communication. It's a great way of stimulating that for young people. So I'm a teacher, but I'm also a parent and I'm a grandmother. And I guess I see my role as an adult now as an awakener for young people, providing opportunities for that awakening to take place, which is terribly important. And it would be lovely if we could see all kids getting into the mud like these two. The muddier, the better. For me as an educator, it's incredibly important that children see themselves as part of a biosystem. And again, in relation to climate breakdown and the changing nature of our planet, this reality that we are part of a biosystem is incredibly important. Before I look at this page, and this also is something that Hayley from the City of Port Phillip has sent out in an email to you, a little resource list. Before I just go into some of the little things that you can do, I wanted to just summarize some of these important points for nature play. It's very important that we plan to give our young people this time in nature. so that they have the opportunity to be in nature, doing the repetitive things that children love to do in order to train their brains, to be imaginative, and to do that over and over to train their brains, to provide them with opportunities for taking their learning out of the landscape back into the home, so that they can extend their knowledge. So I know that my granddaughter has collected lots of bugs and insects. She has her little container, but then so do I. And we often share our little containers of insects. And that's a really important thing that perhaps you could do with your young people, is to actually start a little collection of bugs that are already dead. We found all of these dead bugs out there, and we've taken them as specimens so that we can learn sort of more about their body parts and more of their biology. And she's, you know, she soaks it up. She absolutely laps it up. So this resource list is self-explanatory. I'd like to just point out that the very top one, this naturalist kit, is quite an important element to nature play. So you might like to get yourself a little naturalist kit for your kids. I'm going to stop sharing, and I'm sure that there's lots of questions building up. And as we get the questions, I'm just going to show you a couple of little things. So in a moment, we'll get some questions coming through from the audience. But I wanted to also just describe having a bag to take out in nature, like a reusable bag in which they can put all of their found objects, pine cone, a rock, lots of leaves, the bugs that I just described to you in a little bug. Whoops, they've just fallen out. Beautiful little beetles in a box, a moth, etc. So a little bug box. All of these things can be part of their little nature kit. And then they can come home and use, or do it out in the field, use a magnifying cup to examine their creatures. They can also draw, and this is a wonderful way of recycling old cardboard and making a little strong cardboard with some paper, and they can draw what they've seen. Again, that's part of that effective communication. And they can also, an old baking tray that may be rusty and you no longer want to use it for food, they can use that to lay their things out or make those sensory gardens in. So I know that we're strapped for time now, and we've run over a little bit. So I'm now going to just ask Hayley if there's some burning questions from the audience.
Thanks, Sharon, and thank you, Ian, too. We do have a few questions coming in. The first one was about what kind of activities can you do with very young babies to encourage healthy brain development? Is there such a thing as children being too young for this kind of thing?
I guess I will answer that. The first part of the question, is a child too young? No. A child is born with their brain wanting to be stimulated. So you can start from a very early age. One of the simplest things to do, which is often sort of taken for granted, sometimes overlooked, is to put your baby on his or her tummy. And you can do that from a very young age as well. Tummy time is the most important thing of all. If I could only ever give one piece of advice to a parent about raising their baby from birth, I would say, put her or him on his tummy as much as you can. Maria Montessori, a childhood educator, described the floor as being the gymnasium of the child. It's where the child learns about his or her body. It's where her brain gets all this opportunity. So very simple thing, but very important, is to keep your baby, put your baby on his or her tummy as much as you can from a very early.
Yes, and I'd like to just build on that and say that you can put them on their tummy out in nature. So going to a park and just putting maybe a blanket down for your child initially, but then allowing them to explore the grass as well is terribly important, because they're not just having tummy time, they're getting all of that extra stimulus of being out in the sunshine, bird calls, noises of nature, etc. So certainly that can be taken out into a nature play sort of setting.
There's another question here about COVID, and Ian, you touched on this earlier about the impact the COVID restrictions have had on children's development. What do you suggest parents can do because the restrictions are still ongoing? It may be some time before children can actually go back to play groups or certain facilities. So what can parents do to kind of restore that balance? And also a parent has said that they are hesitant about letting the two-year-old do certain things in the outdoors at the moment due to exposure, and they're concerned about going back to playgrounds. So I guess there's two parts. What can parents do to kind of restore any disruption that's happened during this time? And how? What do you think about going out, taking them outdoors at this time? How can parents best do that?
We're living in a very unusual time. and it's hard to give the right advice because we still don't know exactly what the impact is going to be. The good news is, even if your child hasn't had as much exposure to nature, it hasn't gone out as much, the brain is incredibly adaptive. You won't cause a long-term problem in the brain. That's the good news. In terms of what you can do instead inside, you can actually bring nature inside. You can set up a little corner of a room and have stones and rocks and leaves and twigs. You can build a little teepee. I had a friend who's living in New York, and New York was one of the epicenters in the US, and she lived in a small apartment with a balcony. She set a backyard up on the balcony, so you can do those sorts of things. In terms of when do you take your child back out into the world, you still have to be careful. I don't really know what the right answer. I'm hesitant myself, so I think it's best if you want your child to play with other children, check on the situation with the other family. Are they social isolating still? Not to the degree we were, but make sure they're not going out and doing lots of other things, meeting other kids. So I think you still have to be careful, and ongoing, we still have to be very conscious of what's going on.
I think one of the good things is that we've been encouraged to take our walks and be separated from each other. There are lots of spaces around the city of Port Phillip, and I know many of our audience members today may not be in the city of Port Phillip, but find out what your nature places are in your own municipality, and then maybe make very sort of conscious decisions about going away from playgrounds, if you're feeling nervous about that, to more bush settings where you can be with your child as a family doing nature play. So that would also be one of the things I'd recommend, is just finding those bush settings rather than playgrounds to do nature play in very specifically.
And just on that, Sharon, a question's come through for you about what are your favourite natural places in our local area?
Okay. Yes. So in the city of Port Phillip, there are some very distinct locations. There is St Kilda Botanical Gardens, magnificent. There's a wonderful indigenous forest to explore, lots of logs that can be moved very gently and then just put back into place. Looking under rocks and then putting them back in their place. There is the foreshore. So again, I Luna and I were out there not too long ago on the beach, and she was making a mud forest on the beach, just using things that she found on the beach, shells. And again, as the adult, I was monitoring what it was that she was picking up and, you know, making her forest. So away from people, and we were happily sort of playing there. There's also the wonderful Alma Park. There's the Westgate Park, which is the most magnificent park for bird life. So even if you just go to observe the birds and maybe draw pictures of the birds in the dirt while you're there. There's also Albert Park, which is very understated, but there's a wonderful Nagri tree, 400-year-old tree towards the Fitzroy Street of Albert Park in a lovely billabong bush setting. And that's a gorgeous location for families to go to. It has the cultural significance of our first people that you can explore with your children and also be in a very beautiful bush setting at the same time. And further out from that is in the city of Bayside, if I might comment, there is Elstonwick Reserve, which is a very important body of land that's been put aside for an urban forest and ephemeral wetland. That's where the old golf course used to be in Elstonwick Park. It's now Elstonwick Reserve. Magnificent place for observing nature.
Thanks, Sharon. This will have to be the last question because we're right on 11 o'clock now. But someone's asked, can you please touch on transitioning from nature play to starting school? I find the expectation on children having to sit for a long time instead of exploring the outdoors very challenging.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, yes. So I wish that we didn't have so much of our time for young people inside a building. What you realize when you're an educator for the environment is that you can learn all of the things, like I said in the slideshow, the science, the maths, the engineering, technology, geography, you can learn all of those subjects by being in nature. I wish that we could have outdoor classrooms as sort of mainstream. In the work that the EcoCentre does with schools is that we create those outdoor classrooms for students that have the privilege of us being involved with them. They otherwise may not have that experience, and luckily their teachers have seen the wisdom in taking kids out into place-based nature locations for their learning. It's such a rich environment. And I would suggest that if you're part of a school, get involved in the parents group and gently bring to the table ideas about outdoor learning and how so much of STEM and STEAM, that science, technology, engineering, maths, and then the STEAM is with the arts thrown in, all of that learning can be done in a natural setting, a place-based setting, and it gives so much more to kids. It brings them into that belonging to their place, their nature place, which is so important.
Fantastic. Thanks, Sharon. I just want to say a big thank you to both Ian and Sharon for their time today and for sharing their expertise with us. And thank you to the EcoCentre and Josh in particular for hosting this session for us. You can find more information on Ian's work at developingchildhood.com and braintherapy.com. And also check your emails, because during the session I have emailed all participants a handout with the links Sharon spoke about and some further information on how you can join our first registered Nature Play playgroups in Port Phillip. And if you're already part of an existing playgroup, feel free to share the resources with your group. You may like to include a spot on your timetable for a specific nature play session, or just incorporate some of these activities into your regular playgroup time. Remember that nature play activities can be done from home or in the local area. Just make sure you check out the current government restrictions, and the links are on our handout for that. I just wanted to read out a quote that Leanne posted, which I love. It says, when you see a puddle as a barrier instead of an opportunity, you know you have grown up. And she says, I'm still a child, which I love.
Yeah, that's wonderful. How true. And I thank you, Hayley, and thank you, the City of Port Phillip, for giving Ian and myself the opportunity to share with you today. And if you're a parent taking the first steps in this, find other parents and families to do it with when the COVID protocols allow you to do so, and keep it, you know, take the first steps, first small steps, go and visit your local park and see what happens. Thank you so much.
Fantastic. We'll leave it there. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.